Brenda Perryman Show right here on TV 33, WHPR, Comcast 91 in Detroit, and all over the world, courtesy of the World Wide Web. And also, today we're doing Table Talk. We're going to be talking about, of course, that series on R. Kelly, but some different facets of it. There are different things that have come out. We're going to have two women and two men on our panel at 10 o'clock, so stay tuned for that, and maybe you want to call in. My first show is going to be so great, and you're right here for it. My second guest is Dr. Eddie Conner, who wrote a book called Wife. You'd want to hear about this, Wife. Oh. And my first guest are Bente and Dino Valdez. Bente, they're both so talented. Let me just open up. Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm doing great. I'm getting warm now just talking about it. But I first met them at Manila Bay Cafe. I did some poetry there one night, and it's just a wonderful environment. Well, things have gone on, and things are happening. What we're going to do is find out a little bit about each of them, and then we're going to go into the new project and their gala, which is going to be totally fantastic. So, let's get a little bit of history here. Now, Dino, where are you from?
I'm originally from Michigan. Well, my family started out. My father was in the Army, so I'm an Army brat. We traveled around the country. Actually, in Germany for a little while, too. But I was born in Augusta, Georgia.
Oh, really?
I'm Southern. Migrated to Michigan in 1966. I've been here ever since.
Wow.
Although I did a small stint in high school in the Philippines. My nationality.
Oh, okay.
And that's my company name, Manila Bay.
Manila Bay. That's your company. Now, what is your profession?
Well, at this point, my profession is developing Manila Bay.
Manila Bay, you're developing that,
and basically that's it. We're going to be doing live performances, live shows. It's going to also be a learning center, a cultural center, and we just want to help the community.
Helping the community, and that's what I like to bring to my viewers. What we're doing in the community. Everything for the good. Now, Bente, you've been around a long time. You've been acting, and you're also an artist. Why don't you tell us a little more about yourself, where you graduated from high school and so forth?
Martin Luther King, about 1 million years ago. And I went to Michigan State University for horticultural gardening. And I've had my art company for about 29 years now. I've sold art everywhere locally as far as Paris. So we opened up Manila Bay Cafe, and my photography took off. I started doing that and traveling around with the celebrity Glenda Bridgeport, and just been busy.
Very busy, everybody. But right now, and I went to Manila Bay when it was over on Grand River, and that's where I performed, and there were a lot of poets, and there are a lot of things that are going on in that particular venue, But from what I heard, why don't you tell me why you accepted Manila Bay in the first place?
It was an opportunity. The gentleman that owned the building at that time had that large gallery, which was not being used at all. So he came to my studio one day and said, you know, he's tried renting it to different people for a t-shirt company, a tea company, some other stuff, and it never lasted. So he said if we could come up with anything, we were more than welcome to use the gallery. And I talked it over with Dino, and the next thing you know, we had a poetry venue with jazz and everything. And we started with nothing but an idea and the floor and the walls.
and enthusiasm. Yeah. And I found, because I was just telling somebody the other day, they said, didn't you do that play? That they were talking about a play I did in the 80s outside of school. Because, you know, my profession was teaching. And, yeah, I said I did, but I was so enthusiastic. We started rehearsal in a living room. We didn't even know where we were going to do the play. But, you know, when you're enthusiastic, things work out. They do work out some kind of way. And so how long were you over on Grand River?
As a total, it would be 7 years. I had a photography studio there for 3 years, and then the balance was on Manila Bay.
On Manila Bay. It was just so nice, and it had food. They did have food.
Well, it was Manila Bay Cafe.
Yes, 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 Manila Bay Cafe. And I almost put that on my thing this morning. And I said, wait a minute, I think it's Manila Bay. You know, that's the company, you know. So, right now, you're opening up, or you want to open up a new venue. You already have a venue, but you're going to have a gala called Raise the Roof Gala. Let's talk about that.
Raise the Roof is a fundraiser for Manila Bay, which we are hoping to, you know, raise funds because, really, we need a roof. So, we're asking the community and anyone who will to come and enjoy the night with us. We have our fabulous One Single Rose is our host. She'll be taking care of the evening like nobody else can.
And let me say this about One Single Rose, Rosemarie Wilson. She is so multi-talented. Yes. She's been on my show. I've directed her in two plays, yes. And she just is wonderful. She's not only a gifted poet, she sings like no other. I mean, it's just amazing.
Smooth as silk.
Yes, she is. International, because she has performed overseas also. And tell us about the rest.
We also have for our feature that night would be Angela Davis. We have Randall Wilson and Josh Adams is our comedian for the evening. So Randall Wilson is a well-known artist. He plays the guitar like nobody else. He's traveled all over the world, and we feel very, very appreciative that he made room for us. So he loves us.
Well, he's very talented, and he's the brother of One Single Rose.
Yes.
And they performed at the nursing home that my mother is in. And they're very talented. And Angela Davis. Oh, my goodness. She can sing.
Every time I hear her voice, it gives me chills.
Yeah, she is. She's wonderful.
She's an award winner for the Channel 4 Voice Contest.
Right, right, right. Super singer.
We were actually looking for a feature on One Single Rose Rebirth. And anything, if it's good enough for Rose, it's good enough for us.
Yes, yes. She can spark talent.
Oh,
talent knows talent. Real talent knows. Real talent knows talent. They do. And this is on the 19th, so it's a week from tomorrow, right? Okay, it's on the 19th of January. Tell the audience what is going to be happening besides these great talents.
Well, we're also having, there's food. Lots of good food.
Food,
yes.
We tested some food and the stir fry this young lady came up with.
Stir fry.
It was incredible.
Oh, really?
The food is good.
The food is good. And you have it's a dinner, right?
It's a full dinner. As well with the music. And then we're also having a raffle with the purchase of the VIP tickets. It goes into a raffle where you're going to win Amazon tablets, large screen TVs. Bluetooth speakers.
Oh, my goodness.
A few things that, VR goggles.
Oh, those things that take you out of reality. Yeah, I kind of saw one of those in action, but I didn't try it on. Because I would have fallen off the couch.
Yeah, they make you a little dizzy, but
yeah,
they're fun.
Yeah, I would have fallen.
And tried it.
So it's going to be a big event. It's going to be
a big event. God, like that crunches. You want to try that. You want to try that.
Daring.
Right, right. But it is, tell the audience what you plan to do. You already have a building, but tell them what you plan to do for the community.
In the future, we plan to be able to open it up so that we can have children come in and have free art classes. We want to be able to have SAT classes for teenagers getting ready to go to college.
That's
so
right.
They're really ready for what's coming at
them. Let me tell you something about the SAT and the ACT. Okay, I have a son who just, he was, ninth grade was a bust. And I said, let me start. He started taking ACT and SAT. I had him start in 10th grade. Mm-hmm. Every time it came up, 10th grade. So he got used to taking that test. By the time he was in half of the 11th grade, he got serious about school. And so he was able, a lot of people should know this about the ACT and SAT, is that when you take it, you get a score, and you study some more, and you say, God, I got it this time. I got it even better. You take it again, and it usually only goes up 1 or 2 points. But it does go up. I always tell parents to have their kids start taking it early so they get used to the test. Yes. Well, and a lot of people have test anxiety.
I did, too.
I mean, majority of us
do. I would know the answer, and it's like, if you didn't tell me it was a test, if you say, just do this, I was good. But if you say, okay, we're going to do this test, I'd be like,
I was like that also.
Beaten fast.
Well, that's the artist in us. We don't like anything that's exact. Don't be exact on me. You know, give me some room. Yeah, right, absolutely. So, SAT, that tutoring and stuff like that is excellent.
And it will be a learning center.
A learning center.
We also want to have something for seniors, they can come in and enjoy the night as well.
Oh!
Yes.
I'll be there. I'll perform that night.
Okay.
I'll perform that night. You know, that's my group.
Yes.
But also the young people in my group. Because that night, I never forget that night. All these young people were performing. I said, oh, Lord, here I go. I get up there.
And you are fine.
I know my stuff. What got me, there was this other older man. Does he still come around and do the poetry?
I haven't seen him since we...
Yeah, he was older than me, man. And I've seen him a couple of times perform, and I said, wow.
That's what I like, though. Our audience ranged from anywhere 18 to 75. It didn't matter how old you were. It was what you wanted to do.
And what you want to bring. And
as long as you are respectable, you can perform on our stage.
Absolutely. So, tell people where this is going to take place. Again.
Okay. It's going to be at the Rescue Mission, which is right off of Woodward.
At 150
Stimson Street in Detroit. All the information is on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And
under what?
It's under Manila Bay Proudly Presents.
Manila Bay Facebook page.
Yes.
Manila Bay. Right. You can look at it right now because of you might be on your phones anyway. Mm-hmm. People.
Right now, we're also having a special online discount price only today.
Okay.
So you have to go to the page.
There's a special today. Right, because it's for a great cause. These people are really sincere. You know, because people don't have to do this. People don't have to open up venues in the community. They don't have to do this. These are two talented people who don't even need to do this. But it's a passion to, well, one thing, the arts. Detroit is famous for the artists who have come out of here. I just was contacted from Toronto about it because these people were watching my show, interacting, and they wanted to get in touch with one of the artists I had on my show. You know, and I mean, it happens. I have people in England. Hey, England, they watch the show and so forth. So I'm really, really very, very proud of that. And this is going to be at the Detroit Rescue Mission, like they said, at 150 Stimson Street in Detroit. And you have, it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful program. It's going to be food. And if VIP tickets, the raffle is included in the VIP. Now, if I don't have a VIP ticket, can I buy a raffle ticket? Can I buy a raffle? Once you're there. Once you're there. Once I'm there. Okay. The dinner is served from 8:30 to 9:30.
And be there.
And music. Music.
Incredible. Incredible.
You will not forget the events. I mean, we have some of the best talent in Detroit.
Yes.
We have the most.
Detroit is known for the world's best talent.
Right.
Yes.
And we have the dopest host who's going to really carry this out. It's going to be a beautiful, beautiful night for an awesome cause. And we're just asking for people to, you know, come and, you know, participate, have a good time, and make a difference.
And bring some friends.
Yeah,
and bring seriously, bring some friends and have a good time that night, because you'll be entertained by poetry, by music, vocal stylings. And these, both of these vocalists are tremendous. And then this guy, the comedian, is Josh from here?
Josh is from here, but he travels around the country.
Okay.
And we were really fortunate to be in his time frame.
Oh, good, good. Because
he's
very funny. And I just think it's going to be a great night. A great night. And because we want to help them get a roof, get their new venue.
Let's raise the roof.
Yes, yes. Get the new venue up and going. And will it be available? Say if somebody wanted to rent it out.
Yeah.
Oh, great. Because
when we're not doing our own performances, there'll be hard rock available.
Okay, and you're going to have a stage and everything?
There'll be a stage and seating. It'll be all set up, and you'll just rent the hall and come in and do your thing.
Well, I'm working on a showcase, so everybody, it's going to be good. I'm telling you. But, I am so happy that you're continuing. That's the other thing. And also, you can look online at manilabayraisetheroof.bpt.me.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and if by chance you want to come but you can't, we do have a donation button. We would appreciate anything that you could help us with. No amount is too small because it all adds up. And every dime is going towards the roof.
Yes. The roof. The roof is not on fire. No, I can't say the rest of it. you don't need a lot of, you know. Oh, Lord. That's an old song. When I think about it, because I remember I was on tour when that thing, that came out. That was
like,
yeah, yes. I tell you. So make sure you go to your Facebook page, Manila Bay. Where else? Where else can we find on?
It's on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
Oh, and Twitter, it's Manila Bay too?
Yes, it's on Manila Bay. You can't get lost. It's all the same. And you can click and, you know, get your tickets. And it'd be awesome. We're looking forward to everybody coming out and supporting and having a good time. And it'll be something that you'll talk about even after it's over, because we'll still be talking about it. It's our first fundraiser, period.
Absolutely. So,
this is actually going to be the first arts and entertainment community center in Detroit.
First arts and entertainment and education.
And education.
Yeah, combined.
Right.
And we plan to give free meals during Christmas and Thanksgiving. But that's a big thing we're passionate about.
And not only that, that's who you all are. I know you all to know that these people serve the community. And the more people we get serving the community, the better the community is. And they are people who are not building, their building isn't downtown. It isn't New Center. It isn't Midtown. It's in the community. And that's what makes it so good. They're building up that community right on Grand River, my street.
That's right, right on Grand River. We're almost like in between Wexford and downtown. So,
all the development is coming towards us.
Yes.
From both ends.
Yes.
So, the area is changing, but you know, it's never fast enough. And until then, we want to get stuff moving.
Right, and you're planting your stake in the right in the community, and that is so laudable. So, everyone, you heard it here, you saw it here, and I thank you both.
Thank you.
Oh, it's no problem. I gotta try and come to this. Really, I do. Well, we have Dr. Eddie Conner on next to talk about the life. I can't wait to see what this is about. We'll be back in a moment. Series, and we're going to also talk about Cynthia Centoya Brown, who was given clemency. But I have a lot of problems with the way they did it. But anyway, we'll talk about that at 10 o'clock. But right now, I have one of my favorite people, a wonderful author, Mr. Eddie, or Dr. Eddie Conner. I keep on saying Mr. Well, you are a Mr. anyway. How you doing? Okay, I know you're cool, but speak up. But no, he's too cool for school, I tell you. Yes, it's always on. I want to make sure my Facebook Live people hear you. He wrote a book called The Wife, but it's not his first book. How many books have you written?
That's number 9.
This is the 9th book. That's amazing. That is really amazing. And you're an educator, too. You've been an educator. And now you're speaking all over. You know, he's been on the Steve Harvey Show nationally. And I'm sure you could tell Steve Harvey a thing or two about a thing or two.
Well, you know, to be on your show is a true honor.
Oh, he just trying to suck it in, you know. Tell the audience about some of your books that you've written so we can get to this.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, the genesis of my writing journey came through me overcoming cancer.
He overcame cancer. Make sure My Facebook Live can hear you.
Absolutely. Overcame cancer, stage 4 survivor, just at the age of 15.
A survivor at stage 4.
And so to really live through dying places and realize your test is testimony, your misery is ministry. Your mess is a message, your stumbling blocks is stepping stone. What God does is your setbacks and set up for your greatest comeback.
Absolutely.
So to find strategy out of your tragedy is really something that was very, very prominent in my life. And living through dying places, even though my father wasn't even there in my life, but overcoming those obstacles and being able to say, I can find the candy canes.
Right. And see, that's the thing. When you are singled out by God, I hate to get real religious, but I got to say this. When you're singled out to survive something that could have taken you out of here, you feel an onus to the world that you have to do something to help others, don't you?
You have a responsibility.
Yes.
Because, you know, you're not really just your own. You have a story, you have a journey, you have something to give back to somebody else to help them to overcome as well.
Absolutely. So what have your books been about?
Well, my books have also been about, outside of overcoming cancer, faith, relationships, developing your self-worth, understanding your purpose. You know, I believe as long as you have a pulse, you have a purpose.
Yeah, and a lot of times people talk about, oh, my purpose, I'm living my purpose, I'm living my purpose. Some people, I believe, are living their purpose, but I believe also that some people are just saying, and I know you're living your purpose. What is a purpose?
Well, I think a purpose is that which causes an alignment in regards to your life to be able to give. It's not about you taking, it's about what you can give to somebody else. You know, Dr. King mentioned the whole aspect of life is not so much about what you can get, it's about what you can give. And so, like that song says, if I can help somebody as I travel about my living, I'll be
there. Absolutely. We've got to make sure everybody hears you. Okay, loud and clear.
It is.
Loud and clear. also, because we want them to hear you giving a good message, and we want to make sure that they hear you. But, you know, a lot of people who are cool don't know how cool they get with their voice, too. Relationships, about responsibility, and you wrote this book called The Wife. Tell us the genesis of that, how it began.
Well, wife is all about, I define wife as wisely inspired, faithfully empowered. And so the whole aspect with that book, and I want to make sure that they see it too, we're going to show it for them. But the whole aspect for life, I define that from the whole aspect is how do we prepare boys and men to be good, strong husbands and fathers? A lot of the onus and a lot of the relationship rhetoric tells women how to keep a man, how to get a man. But I don't think there's enough inside
how
information.
How to get a man? No, I don't.
You know.
I'm just saying. Yeah. You say that, yeah, a lot of people do say, even Steve Harvey, if you get a man, how you keep a man.
For sure. I wanted to come from a different angle. I wanted to come from the whole aspect of who was preparing boys and men to be good husbands and fathers. And I have to say for myself, as I was writing, in many cases I was rapping, because I didn't necessarily see a great example of a husband and father in my own life. And so now when you broach that level, or when you're always hearing the question, when are you going to get married? I mean, I went to the chiropractor early this week, went to my business partner, went to my cleaners, and before I could even get my foot in the door, that was the question they were asking me. Eddie, when are you getting married? And so when you think about that, as you're escalating that whole echelon of life, and you understand that life, yes, you do have a desire for companionship and partnership.
Yes.
And so you think to yourself, am I really prepared for the next level? And if not, I got to start and begin to do that.
So, the type of woman, a man, to me, needs to know the type of woman they want in their life. You know, they, I think that friendship comes first.
Without a doubt, that's got to be the foundation.
Why do you say that? I say that. I want to know why you say that.
I mean, sometimes, when you, in many cases, there's just because you're attracted doesn't mean you're compatible. And a lot of times, we skip that whole level of friendship, and we see some red flags, and we see that there's some a level of lack of compatibility there, and we just maybe stay friends instead of taking that to the next stage.
That's true.
For the sake of the sanity of both parties.
Right, absolutely. But do you think that, you know, I think some people think that they, when they get married, they notice these little things that may be a little sketchy or a red flag, but they think they can change a person.
That's true.
Do you think that's a mistake?
I don't think you can change anybody. I think who you see when you're dating, and I believe you have to date for data. I think you really have to see who somebody is, where they are, and not really ignore those red flags there. You know, what you're seeing, you're going to get somebody's representative for sure. But I believe you also have to say, hey, am I going to deal with their baggage? Am I going to help them unpack? Or are they carrying too much for me to where I believe, you know, the flight is going to crash?
Absolutely. Well, I agree with that, but I don't think a lot of people take that into consideration. People may say, well, we look good together, and, you know, the other things that go with a relationship or could go with a relationship.
We hear a lot about power couple, but sometimes that also means power struggle.
That's true. Why don't you talk about that?
Yeah, you know, a lot of times we get so caught up in celebrity couples, and somebody has it this way, we're trying to keep up with the Joneses. But I believe you have to define, you know, the relationship according to what is it that's going to work for both of you. Not comparing who you are or how much somebody else has to your journey.
Right. Because you could have some things in common.
Right.
But you don't have to have everything in common.
No.
Because one person can show the other person something new. There's nothing like exploring somebody else's world and they exploring yours and seeing if they can handle what your world is. And they say you don't know a person till you live with that person.
That's true. That's a whole different entity right there. There's some things you're just not going to learn and not going to see, you know, I'm sure, with that dating process. But, you know, I wrote it to really push the whole aspect of becoming the right one for the right one.
So, for wife, who is that book aimed to? The men or the women?
Both. But I primarily, there's more chapters in the book connected and really positioned to empower men. In that aspect.
To empower them?
Yeah, to empower them. And also,
why
really,
do they need empowering?
Well, I think that there's a level of empowerment that comes with preparation. When you're prepared, you're also enlightened, you're encouraged, you're empowered to another level to see the real reflection of who you are. So I open up the book with the chapter, Singleness Means Wholeness.
Okay. I know what you're saying. Mm-hmm. Explain that to the audience.
Yeah, I really, you know, I'm more English than math. I actually taught history in school, but English is one of my favorite subjects.
Yes.
But I learned in math class, one is a whole number.
Yes, it is.
And
a lot of people don't think so.
They don't think so.
That's so bad, because, in my opinion, that you think you need another person to make you whole.
Right. Nobody can complete you. Only God does that. And so recognizing that I can be whole in my singleness, I can love myself, I can know my worth, I can see my value, I can define who I am, not based on who I have or who I don't have.
Right.
And really begin to date myself before I expect somebody else to love me. If you don't enjoy your own company, you can't expect anybody else to enjoy yours.
Well, one of my sayings, in fact, I put this in my first book, don't put the responsibility of your happiness in someone else's hands.
Yeah, yeah.
It is not fair to them.
Yeah, it's really not. And you really place too much on that person to try to make you happy.
That is, yeah. But people do that.
They do that. They do that all the time. And you're going to be upset. You're going to blame shift. You're going to project anger. And they're also, as a result of it, either going to put that on you as well, or they're just going to just wash their hands of it and keep it moving.
Absolutely. And they'll say, wait a minute. So you're making me happy. Wait a minute. But you have to be happy with yourself. You have a chapter in there that says, why should I get married?
Yeah. One of my favorite chapters.
I guess you, because people are always asking you. I didn't ask you that this morning. I was going to ask you that, but I said, no, I'm sure people ask him that.
They ask me that all the time. I wrote that from, I used Tyler Perry's movie, Why Did I Get Married, that he wrote a few years ago.
His title. Yeah.
And I switched it to Why Would I Get Married? And really, when you think about, you know, the whole notion of, am I just, what is the root reason for why I want to get married? Is it just for companionship? Is it just to say I have somebody? Is it just to make people not ask me the same question over and over again? Or is it really the whole aspect that somebody who I can partner with has a vision that I share with them?
Absolutely.
I really believe, you know, it's better to wait long than to marry wrong. And, you know, people say I can do bad all by myself, but really I can do good all by myself. And once I begin to walk in my purpose as an individual, your purpose partner will connect with you, your covenant companion, the person who is going to be the husband or wife that adds value, husband or wife that adds value to your life, will begin to ingratiate your life.
Absolutely. You know, a lot of times women don't know what they want specifically.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I've heard some women may want somebody who can help them in life, not only be a companion, we can move up together.
Sure.
There's some women who may want a person to just help them.
Mm-hmm.
There are some, but let's talk about the man. There are many women who are doing good things, great things, living their purpose, and men get intimidated.
Yeah, that's true. Right.
Now, what is that? Why does that happen instead of a man saying, well, both of us together, we can really do some things, instead of, I've seen it.
Oh, yeah.
I've lived it.
Mm-hmm.
Don't they know that what's happening for both of you, you know, once you formed a union, and I've seen many successful women have to end up getting a divorce because all of a sudden this man's intimidated by their success. What is that about? Do you know?
Well, you know, I really believe whoever you intimidate is who you eliminate. And some people really see the other party of getting education or having more notoriety or making more money as an assault on their manhood, their masculinity, or even their femininity. And, you know, when you think in Scripture, in Genesis chapter 2, God gave Adam a helpmate. Wouldn't help to meet the bills. It was actually a suitable individual for them. And so beyond compatibility, I need suitability. And somebody who knows more than me is not really somebody who diminishes me. They're really an asset to me.
Absolutely.
They see something from
a different angle than me. Right.
And I ought to be able to embrace that and not say, hey, oh, you think you are that, you're better than me, so on and so forth. It shouldn't be competition. It should be collaboration.
I never forget, you made me go back in time a second, that I was getting ready to go out, just around to the store. And my significant other said, oh, why you got to put on lipstick to go to the store? What, your fans going to recognize you? I mean, at the time, I was just a high school teacher, you know. I'd be on television once in a while. But I just couldn't understand. I said, what? You know, I'm going there with you.
Yeah, sure.
I want to look good, you know, for myself and for you.
Right, you're representative of him.
Right, right. But I'm just saying, a little thing like that, or if you, okay, buddy, you get a wife, you tour, you're going to be speaking across the country, you're going to be speaking a lot, you're going to have a lot of notoriety, you'll even be on the Today Show and forget about the Brenda Perryman Show. But anyway.
No, I won't forget about that.
But anyway.
I feel you, prophetess.
Yes, but here's a woman.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, she said, huh, he going out of town. I bet he meeting somebody else. Sometimes people get threatened. They may have that jealousy, too.
And insecurity, yeah.
And insecurity, yes, yeah. Absolutely. What kind of woman is Dr. Eddie Conner looking for?
That's a good question. That's a good question.
Yeah. Tell us, what are you looking for?
Well, you know, beauty is only skin deep, but it is, you know, important. You know, somebody who is not just beautiful on the outside, but also beautiful on the inside.
Now, beauty's in the eye of the beholder.
This is true.
There's no set, you know, some people.
That's true.
I've heard some men say, well, I like light-skinned girls. I like my girls brown, dark-skinned. And why is that a criteria?
Well, you know, we get real hung up on preferences, and in many cases, sometimes what society pushes into our face, we begin to change our preference to fit what is popular. And I need somebody in my life who loves God, who knows who they are, who's
testify.
Self-assured,
testify.
Who's goal-oriented, whose personality is a fragrance and not an odor.
A fragrance and not an odor? A personality that's a fragrance? And not an odor. Because an odor turns you on.
That's right.
Okay. And, okay. You need that. What age?
What age?
I mean, do you want her to be your age? Younger? I mean, are you going back to the 22-year-old? Or are you going back?
I think that's a little too young for me. Especially in a day and age when people are trying to survive a certain R&B artist. I would say somebody who's closer to my age, and in many cases, stage of maturity is greater than age, you know.
Absolutely. Yeah. We have a call. Yeah. Good morning.
Good morning to your guest.
Good morning.
Good morning to both of you. I have a question for your guest.
Yes.
I want to know if he's saying that one is a whole number. I have two questions, actually. I need to know, does he think that he could be a whole, his whole life as one? Is that a possibility, does he think? And I also want to know what he thinks of marriage contracts. For instance, marrying someone for a limited period of time, seeing if it works out, and if it doesn't, mutually ending it.
That's rather unique. I really think you find, in many cases, wholeness from your brokenness. And I've had to find that loving myself, knowing my worth, even overcoming obstacles in my own life, grappling with cancer, depression, people who didn't think I would amount to anything. And so from that aspect of not just going through, but growing through, to find that level of wholeness is where I believe you can really begin to live your best, and not just your best life, but your blessed life for the rest of your life. To tackle your second question, I wouldn't say myself particularly I would be a partaker of a 30-day or a 1-year marital contract. A lot of times we're treating relationships now like phone contracts.
Yeah, phone contracts.
It's let me try it out. Take a taste test. I want to do my inductive study, know a person's history, but also not just their history, a bridge to their destiny, to see if it is that type of individual. But I would even, marriage is a risk.
Yes.
So I would have to literally take the risk with that individual and say, we're going to do this, and for better or for worse, sickness and in health, and we're just going to grow together through whatever we go through.
But what I think about that contract thing, that would always be in the back of my head. I said, I only got 8 months left on this contract. Is it going to work or not? My head. Yeah. I mean, that's the way
absolutely.
I am. But you have a chapter in the book called Life for Life.
Yeah, right. Life for Life. I don't want to just do something for just half of my life or just for 30 days or 40 days or whatever the case may be. Forever. And really that comes from the whole aspect of he that findeth the right findeth the good thing, obtaineth favor of the Lord, that scripture. And I believe every woman is not necessarily a wife, every man is not necessarily a husband. And I think it really is a growing process, it's a maturational process. In many cases, a lot of women already have the intangibles of what it is to be a wife. But you're his wife when that man finds you, when he locates you, when he says there's something about you that goes beyond what you have on the outside. I want to get to know your value on the inside.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And sometimes, if you hold within yourself.
Right.
And they say if you do love yourself, it's easier, or not easier, but to love another person. You know how love feels. You know how to share love.
Sure.
Sharing your love is very, very important. And see, if people are together, they can be together. I know of a couple who are like 60 years married. I mean, you know, when you get married and stuff, you have that spice of life, physically, mentally, and all this stuff. But sometimes the physical just kind of slows down a little bit. And you have to be able to live with that person, and you want them to be your friend.
Yes, there we go. Right.
That friendship is a heavy, heavy word.
Yeah. Absolutely. And you hear people, couples say a lot of times, especially a lot of couples who I know are in their 30, 40th year of marriage, they say, I married my best friend.
That is. Yeah, I mean, that brings tears to my eyes because sometimes you could be married to a person and say, golly, if I wasn't married to him or her, I wouldn't even want to be her friend or his friend. And that's bad.
Yeah, yeah. There's some people who you love but you don't even like.
Explain that.
I love you because I'm related to you, because we have a rapport, but or whatever the case may be, because you can do something for me. But some people, you just don't really like them. You tolerate them. And to have both working in tandem, loving and liking somebody, I think that is a good recipe for a good relationship that has longevity.
Well, this book, I'm telling you, I mean, and it's funny because the movie The Wife. You didn't even know.
I had no clue that it even came out last year.
Yeah, it was a good movie.
Not only was that an award-winning movie, I believe this is an award-winning book.
Yes.
So it's coming out February the 14th on Valentine's Day. Yes.
On Valentine's Day. Where will people be able to purchase it?
They can get it on Amazon. They'll be able to get it on Barnes & Noble. You can also get it as an Audible audio book. It's called,
oh, really?
Yes, I did the audio.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, about 5.5 hours worth of hearing my painstaking voice. So, but also you can get it on my website, and you can even pre-order now, eddieconnor.com. That's EddieConnor.com.
Well, what I was going to ask you about is this one chapter, Issues, It's You.
Yeah.
What is that about? I mean, give us just a little flavor of that.
Yeah. You know, none of us are perfect, but all of us are worth it. And I really believe that a relationship is like literally board an airplane. I'm heading on a cruise this coming Monday to the Cayman Islands and Ocho Rios. And I realize this, that if you have too much baggage, it's going to cost you. It might make the plane crash. It might make the ship wreck.
Yeah.
And so really alleviating the baggage and healing from the vestiges of your past and taking the time to loving yourself, engaging in what it is that is going to feed you spiritually, internally, emotionally, physically, mentally so that you don't seek somebody else as your source.
Well, let me just say this real quick.
Yeah.
I think people, too, have to be open to love.
Yeah.
You have to be open to it.
Right.
A lot of people, and you talked about the past, a lot of people are still thinking about the past when they meet another person.
True, true.
And that is a handicap,
right.
I believe.
Yeah.
Don't you?
Without a doubt, because if you bring that level of baggage, a.k.a. suspicion, now that other person's love begins to raise as well. Because you're suspicious of me, I might need to be suspicious of you, too.
Right.
So bringing that level because of how somebody mistreated you, mishandled you in the past, until you heal from that, it's better just to stay on your own.
I'll say. Listen, Dr. Eddie Conner, eddieconner.com.
That's correct.
Starting February. You could pre-order the book.
You can pre-order right now.
But it's also going to be on Amazon.
Right. Barnes & Noble, iTunes, Audible, wherever books are sold, everywhere in all the outlets, February the 14th.
Absolutely. That's wonderful. Eddie Conner, this is a great book. We all need to heal. See you. So, wait, thank you. And I'll see you in a few minutes with Table Talk.